Finally.
Away, Townsend, South Africa 1, Renwick, Great Britain 2, Biedermann, Germany 3, Lochte, USA 4, Laveau, France 5, Fraser Holmes.
Eratri Kayur, did the crowd really affect your performance in any manner?
Hi there, thanks for your message about did the crowds ever affect my performance. I think when I was younger and I first swam at my first major championships in the Commonwealth Games in 2006, there was a huge Australian crowd, and of course they only wanted the Australian swimmers to win. So that was quite daunting, going into a crowd that essentially wants you not to win. They want the other guy to win. So that's something you kind of have to manage as a swimmer. You've almost got to feed off the energy of the crowd and use that to your advantage in a race. I remember in 2012 leading out into the men's 200 freestyle final. I was ranked 6th in that race, and everyone in the crowd was just chanting my name. There was about 18,000 people there, so that's just something I'll never forget, which is a pretty awesome experience.
Well, it promises to be one of the great races in all the sports in London, I feel. This means 200 free, because it's bringing together the best of a range of distances.
The crowd is chanting Robbie. It's fantastic.
You know, having almost the same amount of people in a football game turn up to a swimming race, you know, something us swimmers, we're just not used to. We're usually used to having our teammates, our family, our friends in the crowd, but not really all these fans and spectators. So it was definitely something that I wasn't massively comfortable with throughout my swimming career, just because that's not what swimming was really used to. But, you know, if there's crowds and the people in the audience, you've got TV cameras on you as well. So who knows how many million people are watching you as well. So you've almost got to just forget about all that and just concentrate on your race. And that's what I did. And that's what I did in training. Every single day I planned out exactly what I was going to do in my race. So when it came to the race day at the Olympics, it was, you know, the crowd was amazing. TV cameras, millions watching you. But I was just solely focused on the job, which I knew what I was going to do. Thanks.
Hi Robbie, my question for you is, how old were you when you qualified for your first nationals?
Hi there, thanks for your question. How old was I when I made my first nationals? So I think I was about 12 years old. So up in Scotland we have the Scottish nationals, and there aren't as many people there as there are at the British nationals you usually have down in Sheffield. So I think it was a little bit easier for us in Scotland to qualify for nationals. And I remember my first ones, I never really did anything special at all. I think I made the final a couple of times, but I never got a medal. And it wasn't until I was about 14 or 15, that's when I started beating people. I started to grow a little bit more, and then I was actually able to win a few races. So, you know, from my first nationals, maybe 1 or 2 years later, I was actually winning medals. So that's not to say that I went straight into nationals and started winning medals, not at all. I hope that answers your question.
Hi Robbie, Aritra here. As you know, swimming is considered as an individual sport. Can you give us some points on team bonding in relays or even as a club?
Hi there, thanks for your question about pointers on relay teams. So for me, the relay teams were always really, really exciting, because not only are you swimming for yourself, you're swimming for three other guys, and you will always find that everyone in your club gets really, really excited for relays. So I always found I was able to swim just that little bit faster in relay teams because I knew I had the support of the guys behind me.
Over swim this first 50, so Connor Dwyer gives Reed Malone about a body length lead over Russia up there in lane one. Great Britain running third.
So I'd make sure that's, as a pointer, I would say, make sure you swim absolutely as fast as you can for your team in the relays. They're always the most exciting part of swimming, I think, and especially towards the end of a competition. You know, if you swim well and then your whole team does well, it kind of bonds everyone together really nicely as well. So Yeah, I would definitely try your best in the relay.
There they are, the big three, Great Britain, Australia, and the United States, all with a chance to get the gold in the 4x200 freestyle relay.
Well, we hope you're well. My question to you would be, how are you mentally prepared for a race?
Hi there, thanks for your question. Looks like you've already got a swimming pool there, which is great. How do I mentally prepare before a race is a very good question. For me, I try to keep things very, very similar for every single race I do. I know exactly what my warm-up's going to be, what time I'm racing, so that once I know what time I'm racing, then say I can work back about an hour and a half from that. And I can start my warm-up, I can start getting ready, get my suit on, have an energy gel, just start to relax and really focus before a race. I've said in quite a few of my other videos, the way I really prepare for a race is probably in training. So I almost kind of visualize myself putting myself in the race scenario in training. So whether I'm doing a 100 freestyle max effort in training, I'm trying to make that as close to what I'd actually do in a race. So that I've been there so many times on the race day. So come the race day, it kind of feels automatic. You just get in, you know exactly what you're gonna do for the first 50 and the second 50. And of course you've got competitors left and right, but having worked, you know, as hard as I could in training, I knew I was tougher than these guys. I almost knew all my opponents' strengths and weaknesses. I knew some of them could go out really fast, some of them will bring it really fast back, or they have a really good underwater. So I'd make sure if that was the case, I was on it. I was on my game so that I could, you know, I could get in there and race as fast as I could.
Hi Robbie, my question for you is, what age were you when you realized you'd become pro, and yeah, what motivated you to like become pro? Thanks, that was my question, bye.
Hi there, thanks for your question. So when I was 16, I qualified for Commonwealth Games in 2006. I actually won a silver medal there, so that was the kind of first major achievement I'd ever done in swimming, racing against some of the fastest guys in the world. So it was really at that stage that I decided to become professional at swimming and just focus all my time on swimming, because I knew I had the Olympic Games 2 years away in 2008, which were in Beijing. So I wanted to just completely focus on that. And also I had some training camps abroad for about 2 months. I remember going to California and Australia in the winter of 2007, which was amazing, leading into the 2008 Olympic Games. So I was lucky enough to get UK Sport Lottery funding as well. So I was able to pay my rent, I was able to buy food, and just focus on swimming full time, which was, you know, a really great experience for me.
Hi, my name's Josie. I was wondering if there was ever a time in your career that you were demotivated or wanted to give up swimming. If so, what motivated you to carry on?
Hi there, thanks for your question around about motivation in swimming. I think it's normal for everyone to kind of go through ups and downs, especially when you're a teenager and you've got other commitments like school, and maybe you do other sports, for example, and you're not quite sure if you want to stick to swimming. For me, I only really swam when I was younger. I didn't really do any other sports, and I was quite good at swimming when I was, you know, fairly young age. So, you know, being good at something, seeing improvements, getting PBs, those kind of things, they really help me to stay in the sport. And it is, of course, it's different for everyone. Not everyone can be an Olympic athlete, and there's absolutely nothing wrong in that as well. Some people have different talents, whether that's in academics or music or drama or different, a completely different sport, and that's absolutely fine. I would also recommend not pigeonholing yourself into one sport from a very young age. That is something that I did. Swimming just kind of consumed my life, and there was definitely times where, you know, I wanted to quit because, you know, all my friends were out there having fun and I was having to go to a really hard training session, and I just really couldn't be bothered. But for me, kind of looking at the bigger picture as well, that I was doing really good things in my swimming. I was beating people. I was still getting PBs. This kind of thing really motivated me just to keep swimming. And like I was saying at the start of this message, it's completely different for everyone. You've got to find out what works for you. If swimming is your thing, then great, you should go for it. But you know, if you fancy doing something else, there's absolutely nothing wrong in that as well.
Guy is breathing to his left, and he's starting to run him down.
James Guy closing the gap.
Seeing what he has left, but he's not going to have enough here. James Guy is going to close. Weiss is going to get the silver for the United States. Great Britain has another gold at these Worlds. Australia settles.
It is not Russia. It's not Australia. It is Great Britain that puts an end to it all.